Okay, so my starting point will be this picture, which is from a recently put paper on archive, just to tell you that my perspective will be from the more global perspective of policy search when using continuous actions. Okay, and in fact, in this domain, you can distinguish two broad classes of techniques. One class is the episode-based technique, where you perform episodes and you get some return about your episode, and you will try to improve your behavior with these returns. And the other one is step-based, where in fact, at each time step, you get a reward, and you can use the return of this step reward to improve your technique. And what I want to stress, several few things. At the moment in the field, there is a very active, there is the beginning of a competition between deep reinforcement learning methods, which are here, and evolutionary or deep neuroevolution techniques, which are more here. Okay. So I will focus just on this part, but I wanted to stress that some of the methods here are closer to those ones, and I will show that there are some compromise between those families that different algorithms here are playing with. Okay. In particular, to make the point immediately, some of these methods are using Monte Carlo techniques. So they perform complete episodes, and this makes them more stable, and you will see that this, in that respect, they are very close to those ones, and I won't describe those ones at all. So the key feature of the techniques here is that they learn a critique in some way, okay? And the critique is an estimate, a representation of what is called the value function that tells you the value of being in a state or the value of being in a state and performing some action, okay? Those three or four first slides are just to give you an overview of where I am going to. Okay, so I will show this slide again in about 50 slides. Okay, this is just to tell you that I will try to present most of these algorithms, not in details, obviously, but I will start with DQN and present in more details DDPG. Okay, and I will try also to show you the current state of the art with SAC, TD3, and D4PG, and to explain to you what are the main forces driving the field in different directions. Okay, and everything that is written here will be more clear at the end of this presentation. So that's my goal. This picture is the target message. Okay, I want also to outline the fact that this will be quite focused in the sense that I will just focus on performing reinforcement learning with one single task. Okay, I won't even cover model-based reinforcement learning. I will focus on model-free reinforcement learning, though model-based reinforcement learning is quite important. I won't cover at all a very new and active field, which is called meta-reinforcement learning, where you try to learn bio-reinforcement learning to obtain reinforcement learning architectures. That's quite interesting, but this is a little expensive in terms of computation. I won't cover hierarchical RL. And finally, I won't cover at all multitask reinforcement learning, all the topics that are very important for the Flowers team, and that will be more covered by students tomorrow. So I will really focus on the core, which is reinforcement learning for one task. so that those of you who lose interest in the conference, I have prepared the take-home message in the very beginning, and I will give them again in the end. So one take-home message that I will try to explain is that you have Monte Carlo methods and temporal difference methods, okay? And in particular, off-policy temporal difference methods, I will try to explain what it is, are much better at reusing samples that have already been seen by the agent. But they suffer from bias and they may run very unstable. Okay. By the other side, Monte Carlo methods suffer from variance. they reuse much less samples, but they are much more stable. So you have a compromise between the two. Either you want to be very stable and slow and you will use Monte Carlo methods, or you want to be very sample efficient and you will rather use temporal difference methods. Okay. And I will show you also that what is called n-step return techniques offer a compromise between both families. And this is what is one of the hot topics at the moment of, let's say one ingredient of several state-of-the-art algorithms is using n-step returns at the moment. So I will try to explain why. And also I will try to make a point about the difference between using stochastic policies and using deterministic policies. Okay. And one point that we discuss a lot with Nicolas Perrin here is that, in fact, using stochastic policies is above all a question of exploration. You use the stochasticity of the policy to explore different states, and exploration is very important in reinforcement learning. Okay. But having deterministic policies can be a better idea in some families of problems. So combining deterministic policies with dedicated exploration mechanism might be a better idea than using stochastic policies. Okay, that's points to be discussed, let's say, during this presentation. So now the outline of the talk. I will just spend 10 slides to give a quick presentation of reinforcement learning in the discrete action, discrete state case. Okay. These slides are taken from a class that I am giving to master students, which is about 1.5 hours long, so it's very short. So if you don't know anything about reinforcement learning, probably this will not be completely enough, but I will try to present the concepts that you need for what follows. And I would prefer to avoid spending too much time on that. Okay, so let's see. If you are asking many questions at that time, I will have to determine what to do. Once this will be done, I will present to you DQN, which is the basic deep reinforcement learning algorithm with discrete actions but continuous state. Okay, I will tell you about several improvements over DQN from different papers. And then I will switch to DDPG, which is the basic continuous action, continuous state reinforcement learning algorithm, actor critic algorithm. Okay, and this one I will cover it rather in detail. So I have about 20 slides about this one. Okay, then I will list a few different algorithms from different families, and then I will go back to my big picture because then you will have the material to understand the details. Okay, excuse me. Okay, I don't know what it is. Ready? So let's go. So that's my 10 slides about reinforcement learning. So in reinforcement learning, you have an agent which interacts. Okay, maybe I should first ask the question, who has never heard about reinforcement learning before? Is everybody familiar with this picture, more or less? Okay, so I can go fast. So you have an agent who interacts with an environment, it gets some rewards, it has to determine some actions that are sent to the environment, and it gets a new state and a new reward. Okay. Okay, I skip this. The important concepts in reinforcement learning are the concept of the policy. So a policy is having an action in any state. Okay, so here you have an example with discrete states, which are the empty cells, and you have one action per cell, so you have a policy. Okay, this one is deterministic, but you could have a stochastic policy if you had several arrows with probabilities going into different directions. Okay, so one concept is the policy. The second concept is the value function. So the value function tells you what is the value of being in one particular state and then following a particular policy. Okay. So here, for instance, if the cheese is worth 1, probably being close to the cheese is worth, let's say, 0.9, if you have a discount factor of 0.9. And you can compute the value of being in all states if you are following the optimal policy that is shown here to go towards the cheese. Okay. And the third concept that is very important is the action value function. So that's the value function, and that's the action value function. And this tells you the value of being in that state, doing this action, and then following a particular policy. Okay, so that's related to a particular policy. And that records the aggregation of the rewards that you will get by following this policy after having performed this action in that state. Okay, is everybody familiar with all these concepts? Okay, so I can still go quickly. So in dynamic programming techniques, which are in fact planning techniques like value iteration, policy iterations, etc., you get your MDP. So you have, again, your policy is defined by states, actions, a transition function, and a reward function. So you have your MDP, and you compute an optimal policy with using a value function. Okay. So everything is given, and you compute, so you plan. Okay. In reinforcement learning, you want to get the optimal policy, P star, without knowing the transition function and the reward function. So you will have to discover that going doing this action in that state leads you to that state and getting that this reward. And this is why you need some exploration. It's not given in advance. So you have to try mostly everything if you want to be sure that you know everything. Okay. For doing so, there are different approaches. I will start with the model-based approach, which is the most obvious if you have first studied dynamic programming. That's what I do in my class. So what you do is just you go into your environment, so you try different actions in different states, and you record a model of what is the next state when you are in that state and you do this action, and also what is your reward given the different actions that you take in the different states. So you build a model, and then you apply that dynamic programming to this model, and if you are lucky, if you explore enough, your model will converge to the true model, and you will converge to the optimal policy. Okay, that's I won't cover that, so this is quite interesting in terms of sample efficiency, etc. The model-free approach is a little more complicated. You want to get the optimal policy without trying to estimating those models. So I will tell you in a few words that in fact you can improve your current policy very locally at each step, without trying to model what will be the consequences on the long term. And that's what Q-learning, etc. is doing. And I will also show you that actor-critic approach is a special case of model-free. Some people tend to be confused with model-based because here you learn two things, but this is not the model and the policy. This is the critique, the value function, and the policy. I need those equations for what will follow next. So in temporal difference methods, in fact, what you do is that you have your value function, which is initialized eventually randomly, and you have what is called the Bellman backup, or the temporal difference error, or the reward prediction error, that tells you how to update your value function locally, given the step that you have just taken. Okay, so you were in state ST, you had those estimates for the value at ST and ST plus 1. You have performed an action and now you are at ST plus 1. And you get a reward. And you compute this thing. And if this thing is positive, this means that the rewards that you got was higher than what you expected given your values. So you should increase the value of being in that state because you got a reward higher than expected. Okay? If delta is negative, you should decrease the value of V for the same reason, because this means that your estimate of V was lower than it should have been. Okay, so then by applying just an update, I should increase my value multiplied by a factor alpha of the term delta, which can be either positive or negative. It is shown that your value will converge to the true value function of your problem. So that's temporal difference methods. Okay. The point is that if you are a reinforcement learning agent, just by applying those equations, in the end, you will get the value of every state, but you don't know how to go to a particular state. In fact, you have nothing that tells you, okay, you are in state S3, I want to go to state S5, what should I do? Okay, so there are different solutions. Okay. In fact, one cannot infer the policy just from the value function. You need also some model of the transition function. Okay? So either you learn a model of the transition function and then you are in the case of model-based reinforcement learning. Okay? I won't cover it, I say it again. Okay? Or you switch from using V functions from using Q functions, and that's what QLearning and Sarsa do. And in that case, if you know that this Q of SA is bigger than this Q of the same S and another action, then you know which action to choose, okay? And the third solution is the actor critique method. And again, I will tell you how to do so. You learn the value function and simultaneously you update your policy. I should say that in this presentation, in fact, I am following the organization of the old Sutton and Bartos book. I have not read the new one yet, but this is how they go from concept to concept to introduce those algorithms. So in Sarsa, this works as follows. So you add the TD equation that I gave you just on the previous slide. And in fact, you replace V of ST by Q of ST AT, okay? Just literally. But here you have a problem. You have V of ST plus 1, so you take just Q of ST plus 1, AT plus 1, and the rest is the same, okay? And it is shown that if you iterate this and you choose the best action at each time step modulo some exploration, then you will converge to the optimal policy. The point is that for doing so, you have to know that you will do AT plus 1 at the next time step, whereas you don't know yet whether you will be exploring or exploiting or something. Okay? So those algorithms are said on policy, because you have to know what is your policy. That's the concept that I wanted to introduce here, because I will use it later on. Okay. And this makes the proof of convergence a little more involved than the one of QLearning that will follow immediately. Just a funny thing. In fact, so Sarsa is more obvious when you start from TD learning. Salut. And okay, in fact, QLearning was proved in 92. The proof in Watkins' PhD was incorrect, in fact, so Diane fixed it. And what's funny is that it took 8 more years to get the proof of Sarsa, whereas the algorithm is very, very similar. And during the 8 years where Sarsa was not proved, everybody was using QLearning. So QLearning is much more popular than Sarsa. So they perform more or less the same. And they are very, and in fact, it was proved finally Sarsa. So there is no reason to prefer QLearning. Anyways. So in QLearning, the update rule is exactly the same as Sarsa's, but the fact that here, instead of using Q of ST plus AT plus 1, you use the max over the action. So you don't need to know what will be the action you will perform. You just select the best action as you know at the moment for performing this update rule. Okay. And this makes your algorithm off policy. You don't need to know what is the policy you are using to train this, to perform this update rule. And you can use a different policy from the one that you are training at the moment just to performing this update. And so your algorithm is more flexible because you can reuse data from different policies. And you will see that this is very important for deep reinforcement learning. Okay? So I will try to show you a small video of what... Okay, here it goes. So here you have an agent that is doing QLearning in an environment where at the beginning all the Q values are zero. And in fact, it's moving and propagating zeros everywhere. So it's just performing random search. And once it goes to some state that has some value different from zero, it propagates and it starts again and it will perform random search and again and again and again. So this is very, very slow and very, very inefficient. And here in my standard class for master students, then I switch to model-based methods and I show them that with model-based methods, the values propagate through the model very efficiently and this is much better. But I don't need that, so I just wanted to stress that QLearning is something very inefficient from the first principles. Okay, let's go back. And finally, the last Kickstarter part. How do you go from QLearning to actor critique? Okay, so in QLearning, you have this Q table. Okay, and in fact, if you are an agent, you are in state E2, you have to check the different action and say, okay, my max is here, so I'm performing A2. and then you move, you move, you move, you go back to E2, and then you have to ask again, where is my max action? Okay, that's A2, and okay. So if you have many, many actions, this is very inexpensive. In the case of continuous action, that would be horrible to have to solve this optimization problem each time. So you can do something better, which consists in marking where is the best action in your table, okay? And the next time you go to E2, you just look for the star and you know that this is this one. And this can be represented differently just by saying in E0, my action is this one, And what's this? That's a policy. So you have a critique that tells you what's the value of the different actions, and you have a policy that is updated each time you make an update in this table. If the max is changing, then you update your policy. Okay, so in actor critique techniques, you update simultaneously a policy, which is here, and a critique, so an actor and a critique. And you can see that you can, this is more efficient because this is only when you have some value that becomes bigger than the max that you need to perform an update. And I will show you later on, okay, I will just say you later on, that in fact, in actor critique techniques, in the continuous case, you are looking just for local optimum, which is much less expensive than going for a global optimum. Okay, that was the end of the Kickstarter. So does anybody have burning questions about this? Yes?
So the only trick, the only difference between model-based reinforcement learning and actor critic is just this optimization trick?
No, this is very different. In fact, in model-based reinforcement learning, you learn a model of the transition function. Here, you learn a policy. So in fact, in both cases, you handle two memories of different things. But in model-based reinforcement learning, what you memorize is your transition and reward function, and then you update an actor based on that. Whereas in actor critique, there you don't have a model for the transition function, you just have a model for your value and a model for your policy. Is it, yeah, okay? So, so far, everything was with discrete actions and discrete states. Now the question is, what can we do when you have a continuous state? Salut Alain. Okay, the first point is that if you have a continuous space, you cannot represent every value with a computer, okay? Because you cannot represent something continuous with a computer. So what you will do is that you will use several basis functions, for instance, Gaussians, and you can represent this function, this continuous function, just with a few numbers that tell you what is the coefficient applied to these different Gaussians in a sum of features. Okay, so just here you can more or less see that I have 9 Gaussians. So just with a vector of 9 numbers, I am able to represent this function, but also many functions depending on the coefficient that I will apply to my Gaussians. Okay, so the general trick to represent continuous functions in computers is to have some parametric representation where you have just a number of parameters that determine a continuous function that in fact the computer is not handling by itself. Okay, it's just playing with the parameters. So that's the idea that I will use later on of parametric representations where you update the parameters so as to improve your representation. this particular architecture that I have just sketched, which consists in having weights applied to features and a linear combination of weights, it's called the linear architecture. Okay, that's just a linear combination of features. And this is what everybody was using before deep reinforcement learning. And in fact, in reinforcement learning, this works poorly because those linear architectures are rather bad at approximation. Whereas deep reinforcement learning, deep representations are much better. I will try to explain this. Okay. So the point is that a deep neural network is not a linear architecture because you have parameters that are the weights of your top level layers. Okay, at the top level layer, in fact, if you have one neuron output with weights, you can see it as this is a feature, another feature, and a third feature. And this neuron is computing a linear combination of the features. But in your deep network, you have further parameters there, etc. And by tuning also these weights, in fact, you tune the features themselves. So you adapt not only the weights, but also the features. So the network can find the nice feature function whose linear combination will be the function that you are looking for. This is why it can be much more accurate. Okay. Again, this is I have a whole class about these techniques, and I won't go into the details here. So I will use parameterized representation. So in critique-based methods like Q-learning and, in fact, DQN in particular, yeah, I will have just a parameterized representation of the critique, so this Q function. Okay. In policy gradient methods, I will rather have a parameterized representation of a policy. So I will have some function with some parameters, and I will tune the parameters to get the better performing policy. And in actor critique methods, I will have both, so a parametric representation of the critique and a parametric representation of the policy. So one point, so why deep reinforcement learning, given what I have told you so far? The main point is that approximation with deep networks can be much more accurate than with linear architectures, okay? Provided that you have enough computational power, because this can be very expensive to adapt those representations. Given what I have shown you here, in fact, if you use a deep network, the network can discover the adequate features of the states in particular, but eventually also of the action, in the large observation space. In fact, this will be the topic of Natalia, that some of these algorithms are dedicated to perform state representation learning, so finding the adequate representation of the state as a set of features. And this is something that I won't focus at all here, but that Natalia will cover. Okay? And other point is that all these processes that I will present to you later on rely on backpropagation in deep networks. So if you have a library like Theano, Caffe, Torch, TensorFlow, PyTorch, the last two being the most used now, in fact, you just have to call these routines of backpropagations in these networks, and that this works for you. And in fact, they have improved the backpropagation techniques with different gradient descent algorithms that I won't cover either, but this is a whole field in itself, to find more efficient gradient descent techniques to perform those policy or parametric representation improvement very efficiently. Okay, let's go for DQN now. The stage is set, as they say. So DQN is this, you probably, everybody has heard about DQN, okay, that's this Nature paper where they applied the same algorithm with the same metaparameters to 57, I believe, Atari games like Pac-Man, etc., etc. I don't know the names of all. And that after several weeks of computation with Q-learning-like algorithm, they obtained an agent that was performing on par with human people. Okay, so that's the paper. So what's the idea? The idea is that, in fact, in DQN, you just have one network, which is your critique, which is, in fact, the Q-table. So how does it work? You put the state as input, and in the case of Atari games, your state is several images. Okay, that's subsequent frames of the game. It goes through your network. And at the output, you have just one neuron per action. So in Atari games, in general, you have 8 actions. So you will have 8 neurons. And each neuron is giving you the Q value of performing action 1 in the state, the second neuron of performing action 2, etc., etc. So if your network is already trained, you give a state as input, you look for the max Q value, and you choose the corresponding action and you perform it. So that's like Q-learning, the difference being that now your state space is continuous. Okay, that's very simple. Now I will explain to you how you train your network for doing this. Okay, just a notation, in the rest of my slides, the Q network, so the critique, will be parameterized by theta. And you will see that when I will have an actor, it will be parameterized by mu. Is this clear? Simple for everybody? Okay. So how do you learn the Q function? Here there are some little tricks that I have to explain. First, training a neural network is generally performed using supervised learning. And in fact, in supervised learning, you define a loss function, which is very often the quadratic difference between the output of your network and some desired value. Okay? And you want, this is your loss function, this is an error, so you want this loss function to go to zero. Okay? The question now is, in fact, when you are doing reinforcement learning, this is not supervised learning, so you have to figure out how to use these ideas. So the idea is that if I take this reward prediction error or temporal difference error or Bellman backup equation, in fact, I can recognize that this is minus the output of my network. So this should be something, it's missing the square, but that's not an issue. This should be my desired value. So if I take a mini batch of many samples and I compute the value corresponding to that for each of these samples, okay, and I am applying this. In fact, what I want to do in reinforcement learning is to get my temporal difference error to go to zero. And in fact, just applying standard regression techniques based on this loss function, my error should go to zero, so my Q function should converge to the correct Q function. In fact, what I do is that I take many samples and then I do it on average on all the n samples, and I use the square norm so that it works better. So far, so good. But there is a point that, in fact, this is not truly regression, because my desired value depends on the Q function that I am updating. Okay? So my target, my desired value, is a function of Q. So if I increase Q, it might be the case that my desired value will increase too, and maybe I could run very unstable, because by changing this value, I change this value, and I may be running about after a value that is increasing and increasing and increasing. Okay? This is unstable. So the first trick that I introduced in DQN, in fact, I don't remember, but I will show you that for many tricks, this was not the first time it was used. And I know that for the target network, this is also the case that somebody thought of that before, but this was much less visible. So what they do is that they take a different Q network that I will call Q prime. And if Q prime is constant, then what I am doing is regression towards a constant value. Okay, so that this would work. So what I will do is that I will compute my desired value with Q prime, and I will update my target network only from time to time. Let's say for 5,000 steps, I am using the same target network. So I am just performing regression towards this target network. And then I update my target network so that it comes identical to my new Q network, etc., etc. And this is stabilizing the learning process a lot. I can see from phrases that I have been less clear here. Does anybody want to ask a question? So as to help me to make the point clear, yes?
I'm not really sure how the Q prime network is trained.
Okay, in fact, in the very beginning, you just make a copy of Q, which you call Q prime, okay? Your Q prime will stay fixed for 5,000 time steps. During those 5,000 time steps, you will perform the computation that is here to update Q, but using Q prime as a target. So Q should move towards Q prime. Okay? After 5,000 steps, you copy again the old Q into a new Q prime. Okay? So your target has changed, and etc. And so, in fact, you are updating your Q network from time to time, so it will go towards the correct Q, but with slower update rate. Is this clearer? Okay, so this can be seen as periods of supervised learning or periods of regression over time. The second trick is also something that is very old, but again, it was made popular in the DQN paper. The point is the following. In fact, when you are performing reinforcement learning agent, reinforcement learning, your samples are coming from the history of your agent that is going from state ST to ST plus 1 to ST plus 2, etc. So your samples are a lot correlated because they correspond to the successive states in your the lifetime of your agent. But those regression algorithms that we are using are generally assuming for proper convergence that the samples are independently and identically distributed. This is not the case at all. So what can you do about this? In fact, what they do in DQN, and what was done before by Long Jin Ling in 92, so that's a very old ID, okay, consisted in putting all the samples of the lifetime of the agent into a replay buffer. Okay, that's the paper where you can see a replay buffer for the first time, probably. And then, when you want to train, you will draw samples from your replay buffer randomly. So by doing so, you are breaking the correlations between the samples. So your samples get much more IID, and then your algorithm is much more stable. Okay? Got the idea? Very simple, in fact. And in fact, the DQN is just what I have told you. So the general idea that I have explained, how to compute a critic network, plus the two tricks that I have just explained to you. And if you do so, this will work. More or less. You will have to tune a lot the hyperparameters, but this is another story. Okay, and then in fact, what you do is that you train your network not by samples taken randomly, but by mini batches of samples, because you're particularly in Atari games, what you take as input is images. So you make profit of GPU architectures to perform several updates in parallel. So this is why you use many samples. By the way, if you are not using images, it was shown, I don't remember, was it Schutzkever probably, that in fact, if you are using one sample at a time, it's much better than using many samples, but it's slower because you are not making profit of your architecture to perform those computations fast enough. Okay? And okay, just have a look, maybe if you are interested, at this recent paper from Zhang and Sutton, who better study those aspects of experience replay and show you different things that I am not able to explain here. The general idea is that, in fact, you can do better than doing than taking samples randomly, and I will show you just one idea about this immediately. Any questions about DQN? Everybody is still already sleeping?
How do you tune the hyperparameter?
Okay. Pierre Manseron is not in the room, so okay. There is a very well-known technique which is called grad student descent. So you take many graduate students, they try different parameters, and that's it. And this works very well, but that's a little expensive.
Sometimes.
That depends on the students. Okay. No, that's clearly one of the main issues with those things, which are very sensitive to the hyperparameters. The point is that in the DQN, in the Nature paper, they have found a set of hyperparameters that works for all the games at the same time. Okay, so it's doable. Okay, now a few improvements over DQN. So the first improvement is called, that's not necessarily the first historically, but I will present to you in my choice of order. One guy called Ado van Asselt, who is at DeepMind, as many people, okay, all these people are at DeepMind actually. Ado van Asselt has studied, in the case of Q-learning, the fact that since you are performing a Bellman backup with a max operator, if you get some overestimation in the Q-value of your next state, this overestimation will propagate to the value of the current state. So those overestimations will tend to propagate everywhere in your Q function. Okay. And this does not matter much if you have discrete state and discrete action, because you will have overestimates in the beginning, but that's it. But when you are using parameterized functions, so for instance, neural networks, then some local updates may have effects at different places, okay? And then you will tend to have new overestimation from place to place, and those overestimation will tend to propagate, okay? So in his Q-learning paper, Adolf von Hasselt found a technique which consisted in having, in fact, two Q-networks. One was used to propagate the values, and the other one was used to perform the updates, so as to prevent this overestimation effect, okay? And in fact, they figured out that the same trick could be used in DQN, okay, which is then called double DQN. And in fact, what is nice is that in DQN, you already have the target network and the current network. So it was very, very easy just to adapt Van Hasselt's double Q-learning trick to the double DQN. And this was performing twice better because it was less overestimating the state. I won't describe the trick in detail. I will go back to this overestimation propagation effect with a different paper which is called TD3, that is very recent and that is very, very interesting because it shows that you also have overestimation propagation in actor critic techniques where you don't have a max operator in the Bellman backup. This is quite surprising, but this is very interesting. A second improvement over DQN, so I alluded to that, comes from the fact that in DQN you are taking the samples from the replay buffer randomly, but you can do better. Okay? In fact, if you take samples where you have a greater temporal difference error, you will adapt your critique more, okay? Because your update will be based on delta and delta will be bigger. Okay? So if you give a higher probability of to these samples of being selected, your Q network will improve faster. So that's prioritized experience replay. In fact, you rank your samples in your replay buffer depending on their TD error, and you sample them with some preference for higher TD error samples. Okay, that also has the nice effect that very often, the first time you see a sample, you make a large TD error on it, so they will tend to select very immediate experience sooner. Okay, and by doing so, you also converge twice faster than DQN, than the standard DQN. Okay, a word to say that. In fact, I could not tell you at the moment, but this paper from Zhang and Sutton shows that putting in your mini batch the samples corresponding to the last step is much better than taking just randomly. And in fact, prioritized experience replay is doing this more or less by chance. Okay. Third point, which is more complicated. I will say a word about this later on. But so what's the advantage function? In fact, you have the Q function. Okay. And the advantage function tells you, that's the formula. I will start this way. That's the formula. You take the Q function, you subtract the max of the Q function given the different A. So if your action is the optimal one, your advantage function is zero. And if you take another action, you get something that is smaller than zero, that is negative. And that tells you how much you have lost for taking this action instead of the max. Okay, so that's called the regret for not performing the best action. Okay, this formula can be replaced by this. In fact, the value function is equal to the max over the Q function for the different actions. Okay, so you can also define the advantage function as advantage function is the action value function minus the value function. Okay, so why am I speaking about using the advantage function? There are several reasons which are correlated and that I don't understand in many details, but this will be the internship of Thomas Pierrot to investigate this question in more details. And Nicolas maybe may have things to say about it soon. So first, a guy called Lehmann Baird showed that when using continuous, let's say, functional approximators with Q-learning, in fact, your algorithm may diverge. But when you are using updates using the advantage function rather than the Q function, it gets much more stable. Okay, that's one point. Another point is that Okay, that's technical, and I'm not ready to explain that in details given what I have, the background that I have given to you. But in fact, there is a way to perform reinforcement learning in the continuous case, which is called the likelihood ratio view with the algorithm called reinforce. And in fact, it is shown that the baseline that minimizes the variance is using the advantage function in this stuff. So I'm sorry, I'm missing slides to explain this to you here. And the third point is that Jan Peters has shown that if you are playing with an actor critic architecture with some linear approximators and using some compatibility condition from Sutton, I will tell you a few words about this later on. In fact, using the advantage function corresponds to performing natural gradient descent. Okay. And I will also tell you very quickly that natural gradient descent is better than vanilla gradient descent. So there are different elements that point towards the idea that using the advantage function instead of the Q function is a good idea. And you will see that in the next algorithms, several people have tried to do so and with some success. Okay. And okay, Thomas will have to work on clarifying those things. Fourth idea is called dwelling networks. That's again a DeepMind paper. So as I just shown you, the advantage function is this minus this, but you can also write it the other way around, saying that the Q function is the advantage function plus the value function. In fact, the advantage function tells you the difference between doing different actions, and the value function is the baseline value of the state. You can see this differently, okay? This tells you how good it is to be in S1, and in SI, okay? And if you are in SI, then this tells you that doing this action is doing that better this one than this one. Okay, so this structures your Q function into different components, one about the value of the state and one about the value of the different action in that state. Okay, and okay, a side note is that the advantage function of the optimal action is always zero. That's a regret, and this regret is nil if your action is optimal, okay? Okay, so these guys decided to represent the Q function with some internal structure instead of having a standard neural network. You just have one network for estimating the value of a state, and the value of a state is just a scalar. So this network just has one neuron here, and having the advantage function on the other side and making the sum. Okay. Okay. And something that I didn't say before is that in TensorFlow or different similar frameworks, in fact, you can describe a network where your computation units are not necessarily neurons, but can be any function that is where you can compute the derivative. Okay, so you can use a sum and perform gradient descent on this network. Given that you have a sum here, the TensorFlow will perform the computation absolutely normally. Okay, and by doing so using images from a convolutional neural network, as was done in DQN, again, they improve the performance with respect to DQN. Okay, that's okay. Yes, and in fact, in that paper, they show with a driving car experiment that this representation captures some relevant aspect of the control stack. Maybe you say a word about this? No, okay. And I will show you that in the continuous action case, there is an algorithm called NAF that uses more or less the same idea, but in the continuous action case, so you don't have those N neurons because you don't have N actions, so that's a little more complicated. Okay? And finally, the final paper in this trend is Rainbow. So the main, let's say, advance in the field corresponding to Rainbow is that now they can give you a curve where the color is changing along the, because that's a rainbow. Okay, but in fact they take the four improvements that I have told you, they put this together. They even take different improvements that correspond to distributional DQN, A3C, and what's the third one, and noisy DQN that I will present later on. And by combining those different improvements, they get something that is even better. And in fact, when the Nature paper was published, DQN was performing on par with humans, and now they have a factor about 8, they are 8 times better than humans at playing Atari games. Whoa.
Okay.
That was the end of the DQN part. Any question? Still alive? Okay, so I will switch to DDPG and maybe we make a break after that. We will see. Now that I have presented to you DQN, presenting DDPG is easier. But first, a word to say that we are changing of, we are going into a different world when you want to find an optimum over actions, okay? And performing a maximum over a continuous set of actions is solving an optimization problem, and this is very expensive, okay? So in fact, the kind of problems that we are solving in many of the experiments we are doing at Flowers or at ISIR are very, very difficult because you are addressing a large space of action, a continuous actions, and you want to find the max in this space, and this is very difficult given that you only get a sparse reward signal that tells you that this action in fact is a little better than this one, but this is not told to you very often. So a word to say that in fact policy gradient methods and actor critic methods, instead of looking for the optimum over the whole space, which is completely not doable, will look for a local optimum using a Pontryagin technique rather than a Bellman technique. Okay, that's technical. I don't go into that. And trying to address those continuous action problems has a long history in the field, but I will give you a very quick overview of everything before DeepRL, and then I will go to DDPG. So in the very beginning, in fact, in my when I presented to you the actor critic technique, I could have told it the naive actor critic, in fact, where you are using the vanilla gradient and simply using the temporal difference to perform the updates. Okay, I didn't tell you this, but in the naive actor critic case, you have the critic which is standard. Okay, the naive case is the discrete action, discrete state case. Your critic is standard and it's updated like Q-learning or temporal difference method if you are using the V function. But your actor is stochastic. And in fact, if your temporal difference error is positive, it means that the value that you had for this state was underestimated, so you should increase it. But it also means that the action that you have taken was better than expected, so you should increase its probability. So you can apply the same update rule in an actor critic setup, discrete case, in the actor and in the critic, and that's what is called naive actor critic. Maybe I was missing a slide about this. Okay, but then in 2000, Sutton has shown that if you are using continuous representation for the actor and for the critic, if you want your algorithm to converge without bias, you have a condition between the features of your actor and the features of your critic. Okay, in fact, the gradient of one of them should be the log derivative of the other one. Okay, I won't go into the details. And this gave rise to modern actor-critic techniques where they were using this compatibility condition. Then Jan Peters, inspired by Sham Kakadeh, found it useful to use the natural gradient instead of the naive gradient, and using least square methods to update those linear architectures. So that's regression with linear architectures I have shown you in the beginning. And this gave rise to NAC and ENAC algorithm. And this made Jan Peters very famous with many papers. But to be honest, those techniques don't work that well. Okay. In fact, you can tune some robot to do some things with that, but it's very, very difficult to reproduce such experiments because, you have to tune many hyperparameters for a long time. Okay. And finally, a guy called Bhatnagar, together with Sutton, those techniques were batch, okay, no, were iterative, and this guy invented incremental natural actor critique. I will go back to iterative versus incremental later on. Okay. So the point is that those methods, in fact, were quite inefficient. This could allow you to publish one research paper, but when people were trying to actually use it on robotics, this was not good enough. Okay. And one issue is that value function estimation based on linear regression is too inaccurate. If your value function estimation is a little inaccurate, then your policy could be very, very wrong, because this depends a lot on your value function. And also a point is that in those techniques, you are using gradient descent, and tuning the step size of your gradient descent was very critical and very difficult. So you had to tune the step size for hours before getting something that works. Okay, and those two points have been solved by deep reinforcement learning. Okay, in fact, okay, I'm not there yet. So in fact, know that you are using non-linear regression, you get much more accurate with deep networks and enough data and enough computation. Okay, and tuning the step size is addressed by Adagrad, Adam, and those algorithms. So you don't have to bother about this much more. So using deep networks instead of linear architectures and doing more or less the same as here might be a good idea. So that's DDPG. So the title is Continuous Control with Deep Reinforcement Learning. Again, this is a Google DeepMind papers with many authors. This is the same way of publishing the paper as the Nature one, which means that in fact they tried many environments, many continuous control environments, and showed that with the same hyperparameters they could solve all these environments with just one single algorithm. Okay. Let's say that this is a paper that is a lot cited. It is only 2 years and a half old, and it's already a lot cited. Okay, and like in Atari, you can use just images as input and find the control as output, or give the state representation of your. For instance, if you take the card pull, you just give the angle and the position, and it will find the control. So it works both with images and with the state representation very, very well. But again, you have to play with hyperparameters. We will see this later on. So what's DDPG? That's more or less DQN. So it's reusing the replay buffer trick with the shuffling of samples and the target Q network trick. Okay. But it's based on a different idea and on a different gradient descent algorithm, which is called the deterministic polylistic gradient algorithm that comes from David Silver, also at DeepMind. And it added a third ingredient that was supposed to be important when the paper was published, which is called batch normalization, and I will tell you that in fact a lot of people don't use batch normalization without any change since then. So how does it work? As a reminder, in DQN you just add one critic network with one output per action. Now you have a continuous action, so you get something different. You have a continuous state as input and a continuous action domain as output of your actor. Okay. Here I take an actor with an action with three dimensions. Okay. By contrast, your critique, just you put it as input the state and the action, and it tells you the value of performing that state, that action in this state. So you just have one output. Okay. So the structure is quite different from the one of DQN. And then I will tell you how to train your critique and how to train your actor based on the critique. Word to say that in the original DDPG paper, they were explaining that in fact their critique was a two-layered and actor in fact were two-layered neural network, and that the state was going through both layers and the action just through one layer. Okay, and I have never seen a conclusive study about the fact that this is important. And in fact, a lot of people do not use this anymore, and we don't know why they. But in the that's funny. I just made this small change this morning because I spotted that in the D4PG paper that was published at ECLR this year, they are confused. They put the action in the place of the state and not the other one. So okay, that's. A side remark, but the idea is that you can use different architectures for the actor and for the critique, and that seems to play a role, but it's not so conclusive.
Maybe yes? Just a question about the architecture of the critique here. So for the DQN algorithm, it would have been possible to use also this critique architecture, like instead of having several output neurons
for each action, and you could have also have the action as input and predict a single a scalar value. And so, is there a strong reason that in the DQN they chose they made this choice as opposed to this one? So, for the DPG, for the continuous case, we cannot do what DQN do. But DQN could have used this architecture for the critic.
Yes, but since the action in DQN is discrete, it's not so obvious what to do. Do you take just one neuron and you have 8 levels of values, so it probably won't generalize very well? Or you use 8 neurons for your 8 actions as input, and you use what is called a one-hot representation, so all are zeros and one is at one, and then you propagate. I don't know. This is related to VFA in some way, and I had a discussion, I can't remember with whom, who told me why. Oh yes, that was with Timothy Ospedales, who explained me why this form was more general and more useful. But I have never seen a study about trying to do this with DQN. So how do you train the critic? But in fact, this is exactly as in DQN, but the structure is a little different, so the equations are just a little different. But this is the same idea. This is very similar to supervised learning, so you are using backpropagation of some loss function, okay? What you will minimize is your reward prediction error. So again, your reward prediction error would be this term, which is the output of your network, and this term, and you just subtract this one to this one. A subtlety is that here, instead of having the discrete action that you have in your sample, you are using the output of your actor in this term here. Okay, I will go back to that later on. But that's the only difference, and otherwise the rest is the same slide. Okay, so you can perform exactly the same updates. And again, you can use a target network so as to stabilize it. A point which is a little surprising, but that's life, is that instead of performing updates, some updates of the Q network, let's say each 5,000 steps, they rather have the target network tracking the standard network with some smoothness factor. So your Q network will increase quickly, and your target network will follow more smoothly. And you hope that the distance between the two won't diverge. Okay. From the empirical study of the paper, they show that this is a critical trick, and I will tell you a bit more about this later on because I have studied this with a particular instance of DDPG. And in fact, also very surprisingly, they do the same for the actor network. Okay, so they also have a target actor, and they also have the target actor tracking the standard actor with a smoother update. I see no theoretical justification for doing so. Why doing this for the critic is very clear from the supervised learning versus reinforcement learning equation, but here for actors, I don't see why. Okay. But it happens that it works, and in fact, the TD3 paper that I will tell you about later on gives a hint on why the actor should not move too quickly. And in fact, that's probably related to different ideas that I will tell you about later on with TR Perot, etc., where in fact the policy should not change too quickly. Probably that's very related, though the theory is not put forward in that particular context. Again, actor-critic tuning is known to be tedious because you have to tune the hyperparameters of the critic, but also the hyperparameters of the actor, so you have twice more hyperparameters to tune. So the DPG is very hard to make work with. You have to take twice more students to get it work, let's say. So I have told you how to train the critic, okay, with the same equations as in DQN. Now, how do you train the actor? In fact, David Silver showed in the DPG, so deterministic policy gradient paper, that the gradient of the actor with respect to his own weights can be written as you compute the gradient of the critic with respect to actions. So this tells you that if you change this action in that direction, your Q value will increase or decrease a little. Okay? So it tells you you should move this action in that direction or in that direction because your critique can tell you this. Okay? If you change a little the actions here, you see how the critique moves. Does it increase? Does it decrease? Okay? And then if it's better to increase a little the actions, then you should update your network here so that with the same state, it increases a little the actions. And if you need to decrease them, then you decrease them. So more mathematically, in fact, you compute the gradient of the Q function with respect to the actions. And this gradient that you get here can be seen as the loss function on this one. So you just, you can even, this is done in one paper from Hockness and Ashton, you can even put the actor below the critique and backpropagate the gradient through the whole thing in just one pass, and this works. Okay. Actually, this is a way to perform the operation a little faster. A word to say that this idea of backpropagate, okay, of determining how changing the action will improve or improve your Q function and then propagate it to the actor was already present in one paper from Reid Miller in 2011. But actually, Reid Miller is also at DeepMind, so that's normal that he participated in DDPG. And now, how do you compute those gradients? In fact, in TensorFlow, okay, in fact, first, this is the equation of one layer of neurons, and you can see that the weights and the input are playing symmetric roles. So if you can compute the gradient with respect to the weights, you can, this is very, that this is the same code that can compute the gradient with respect to the input. Okay? And in fact, the action is some of your input. So it's very easy, and in fact, TensorFlow offers you the operations, how to compute the gradient of your critique with respect to your action, just by selecting those inputs that are the action and performing this computation. Okay. Actually, you don't have to mind about those technical tricks anymore because all those DDPG codes are available online, so you don't have to code them again. But the first time that one of my students had to code DDPG, he had to figure out how to do this, and it took us a while to discover that this was the way to do so. Now things are easier thanks to GitHub and the OpenAI baselines, etc. So I told you about a small subtlety. So when you are computing the loss function of the critique, as action you take the action of the actor, the action of the policy. DDPG being said an off-policy algorithm, you might have expected that when performing your update, you are using the state that is in your sample, but also the action that is in your sample. In fact, it's not the case because what you want to know is the gradient of your policy with respect to your critique. So you have to have your critique play the action of your policy and not the action of your sample. Okay? Okay, that's a little more complicated than that. I'm sorry, this is a little technical here. In fact, I have not told you that DDPG is an off-policy algorithm. So it could be trained for samples that come from a different policy, different from the one that you are currently training, okay, the policy that your actor is doing at the moment. So if you were using the action which is present in the sample, you would get the gradient of the value of performing this action in that policy that is not of interest to you, and to change that. What you want is to improve your actor. So you want to know the gradient of what your actor does in the state corresponding to the sample. I must confess that this is a little complicated. Yes?
So in what respect it is an off-policy?
It is off-policy because it's not so easy to explain. Yeah, in fact, the samples that you get can come from everywhere. You can use a random walk in your MDP. Just by applying those equations, it will work. Okay? And then if you want to really know why it can be off-policy, you have to go into the details of the David Silver's paper. And it took me a while to get convinced that, in fact, it was really off-policy. Something that I did not specify at all so far is that in any reinforcement learning algorithm, you need some exploration. here your policy is deterministic, your critique is deterministic, the gradient is deterministic. So if you don't perform any exploration, you will converge towards something, but you won't explore at all your environment, and this won't work. So you need some exploration technique. Okay. In the standard DQN paper, they are using action perturbation, which means that they add to the action some noise. Okay. And in fact, in the original paper, they use what is called Ornstein-Uhlenbeck noise, which is a kind of correlated noise process. Okay. And in fact, several papers, recent papers, found that using standard Gaussian noise is as good as using OU noise. Okay. But from another side, there is a different ways to perform exploration with noise, which consists in perturbing the weights of the network and not the actions. This is called parameter perturbation instead of action perturbation. And we have shown, okay, the paper is not cited here, but with Rixtulp, we have studied the fact that parameter perturbation is very often superior to action perturbation. And those two recent papers that were both accepted at ICLR this year, from Plappert and from Fortunato, improve over DDPG just by adding this parameter noise perturbation. Actually, this one defines the noisy DQN, what I told you that in Rainbow there was a noisy DQN. That's this one that I have not presented to you yet. So, again, to make things to reiterate the things, how do you update your actor and critique? I won't show you again the equations. I have explained to you that. Now I'm giving the algorithm. So first, you are in a particular state. You feed your actor with your state. You get the action as output. Okay, so this gives you your P of S. Okay, then you feed the critique with the current state and this P of S. Okay. Which helps you determine the Q value of doing this action in that state. Then you can perform the gradient computation to update your critique. You can also perform the gradient computation to update your actor. And one thing that should now be obvious is that those two things can be done in parallel. You don't need to perform one before the other one. Okay. So actually, there are several implementations of DDPG where they are making a lot of profit of using things in parallel to be faster. This is the global algorithm. I won't comment it again. So a word about batch normalization. For those of you who have seen Ali Rahimi's talk, this was very funny because he was asking two people, who among you is using batch normalization? And everybody was raising his hand. And he said, OK, batch normalization is about mastering the covariate shift phenomenon. And what's covariate? Who knows what's covariate shift? And very few people was able to raise their hand. Okay, and in fact, okay, to make it very quick, this is a technique that has very poor theoretical grounding. This is engineering to improve stability of those gradient techniques. And okay, Ali Rahimi was complaining that in fact in the field we are using tricks that we don't understand, and that this is very nice. Okay, so. Very quickly, if I want to explain the idea, but again, I am not a mathematician and this is not math anyways. The idea is that when you are training several layers neural network, the fact that you train the first layer has some effect of the input of the next layer. Okay, so the statistics of the input of the second layer will shift along training due to the training of the first layer, and so on and so on. Okay, so this propagates some biases from layer for this infamous covariate shift. This propagates some biases along the layers. And in fact, batch normalization is a way to fight this shifting phenomenon just by renormalizing the signal between each layer by adding a supplementary layer. So a nice thing is that this makes your algorithm much more stable. A very bad thing is in fact that your network is now bigger because you had to add more operations between the layers. And then if you want to compare an actor trained, for instance, with evolutionary techniques and an actor trained with DDPG, if you are using batch norm, you are not using the same actor anymore, so it's hard to compare, for instance. That's one of the bad side effects that we had to fight against at a point. Let's say that there are several other forms of regularization that have been tried. They are included in OpenIE's baselines, and OpenIE's baselines are cited here. I won't go into that. A few words to say that in the team we have studied different implementations of DDPG, and as it is said in one very nice paper called Deep Reinforcement Learning That Matters, it's quite sad that if you pretend to use the same algorithm, which is called DDPG, but you take different implementations from the web, you will get different results each time due to minor differences in the way you regularize, in the way you perform the operation, etc., etc. So it's very hard to get some stable results. This is why actually we decided to use the OpenIE baseline, because this is something that everybody has access to, etc. But I performed a few studies with different implementations of DDPG. And for instance, here I studied the update rate of the actor. One thing that I did not say is that this target actor, if you update it from time to time, the interval between these times being a number, the case where you don't use a target network consists in updating at each time step, so the number is one. Okay. Now, if I rather use a soft update with a tracking value, if I take a value of one, again, it's perfectly tracking the network, so that's again the case without a target actor. So you have a continuity, and so you can study with a continuous value using an update rate of 1/10,000, okay, up to having a value above 1. And we studied with a particular DDPG implementation the fact that we got something that converged more often when the update rate was somewhere between, was in fact close to 0.05, okay. So it was better to use tracking than using scarce updates. A different thing is that at a moment the community got excited by something called the Huber loss, where instead of using a squared function, you use a function that is squared close to zero and linear beyond that. Okay, and in fact we studied with the same algorithm using the Huber loss with different parameters, delta, okay, and we found that the best was to use delta as big as possible, so it was in fact not using the Huber loss at all, so it was okay. But some people use it, some people don't, and again it's very hard to conclude anything because that depends on your implementation of the different metaparameters, etc., etc. That's probably one of the main messages from this talk, is that a lot of people try to use those algorithms with the same benchmark and the very different results, and it's really a mess. Anyways. Okay, another phenomenon that I wanted to point, which is quite important, is that your critique tends to overshoot. Here, this is the continuous mountain car benchmark, where in fact your reward, your max reward is 100, and you get some punishment penalties for the energy you spend to getting to the reward. Okay, so your maximum performance over one episode should be around 90, 95. Okay, and you can see that your critique goes to values up to 120. And then through time, they tend to go back and to converge to the average Q value, which should be around 60. Okay, this is clearly the overestimation bias at play. Okay, this is this overestimation bias that I told you about, that makes it that the Q value tends to grow bigger and bigger. But since you have several mechanisms to prevent instability to happen, finally it goes down again and destabilizes. Okay. One thing you can do to prevent this, because this is often when the Q value is going back to its value that you get some instabilities, what you can do is do some target critique clipping. In fact, Pierre Fournier, who is there, has been using it with quite a lot of success. You know that your maximum value is 100, So you say, I won't increase any Q value over 100. You just clip it. Okay. So this overestimation won't propagate because it's cut. And that's better. Okay. But you need to know the maximum value that you okay. A different trick that Pierre has also used is called the gradient inverter. This is again in Hockness Eshton's paper. The idea is that if you have a bounded parameter domain, the gradient may drive you towards the bound and even beyond the bounds. Okay. And this should not happen. In that case, in fact, your value will get clipped and you will not be able to apply the gradient. So what they do is that in this situation, when you are beyond the bound, they invert the gradient so that you go back. Okay? And it's better than using squashing gradient function, like the hyperbolic tangent function, which is used in the DPG, because squashing the gradient makes the learning process slower, of course. Okay. One thing I am wondering for a while is that I told you when you are performing the update of the critique, you take a mini batch of samples, okay? And in fact, those samples are from very different places along some of your trajectories. For instance, you can get one sample where you get the reward. So you get, if this is continuous mountain car, you will get a reward of 100. And then you have, if your sample is 128 samples, as is often the case in a mini batch, you will get 127 samples where your reward is a small punishment. And maybe if you take the average over all these samples, the average will be zero. So it seems to be a bad idea to perform those averages over different places in the state space. Whereas in the standard Q-learning technique, you are not performing some average. You are making the updates very locally. So I don't know why all these people do this. I've tried to remove that based on the paper of Sutskever saying that using mini-batch as small as possible is a better idea. But actually, the algorithm was so slow that I could not go to the end of the study. But I am puzzled by this fact. Okay. And I also want to say that what I have presented to you so far are tricks to fight against a fundamental instability issue, which is due to the propagation of overestimation bias, and that this instability may still happen if you are not lucky with your data, which is what makes your hyperparameter tuning so difficult. Okay, and this was already true from DQN. So just one word about a paper that was published, let's say, 2 weeks ago, probably. From Fujimoto, that's people from McGill, who are also the people who have written this deep reinforcement learning that matters. Okay, people who study really the inside of the algorithms, and I believe this is the right way. Okay, so they propose different ways to act against the overestimation bias, and the one that works the best consists in having two critiques, and each time you want to propagate a value, you take the mean value among your two critics, so that in average, you will overestimate less often, so you will less propagate. So you need less problem knowledge than in a critic value clipping because you don't need the value R max. And they show that by doing those two critics, also they justify that, they show that if the actor is updated too fast, then you get your instabilities. So this gives an idea of why in DDPG they are using a target actor. Okay. By the way, through personal communication with the authors, I asked them whether they tried to use more than two critics. And they said that if you have many critics and you take the mean, that you can get underestimation bias. So this shows you that you are playing with the limits between overestimation and underestimation, and this is very sensitive. Again, so a word to say that so far I have presented to you things that I hope I have understood rather well, at least DDPG, maybe DQN too. And now I will go to things that I master much less well, and I will do two different things. First, I will start introducing elements for my final big picture. So this will be much more, prospective, okay? And the other one is that for some of the algorithms that I will be speaking about, I may have not understood well. So again, let's be okay. Please take what I will be saying with some with a grain of salt, because I may be wrong from place to place, or completely wrong again. So one difference that will matter between the DQN and DDPG algorithms from one side and some of those that I will present now is the difference between what is called iterative versus incremental algorithms. So I want to make this distinction clear. So to me, an iterative algorithm will, for instance, compute a critique, determine a policy from that critique, then use this policy to generate a batch of samples, a large batch of samples, okay? And from this batch of samples, we'll determine a new critique again, so we'll remove the previous critique and compute a new critique from this batch of samples, new policy, and et cetera, et cetera. So you have a loop, that's iterations, but at each iteration, you get a completely new critique and policy. Whereas an incremental algorithm, you have a critique, you determine a policy, you make a few steps, you get new data, and with this data, you update your current critique with a new critique, but you don't throw the previous critique away. Okay? And in fact, DDPG works this way, because your critique is updated with the content of your replay buffer from step to step, and you can do it, let's say, once every 1,000 steps, or at each time step, that's as you wish. Okay? Whereas TRPO and some other algorithms that I will present it now are more this way. And the good old, okay, the not so good old actor critique algorithms before that were using linear features were all this way. So they, okay. One thing that is important is that one way to compute the critique given a batch of data is using, one way to generate a batch of data to compute a critique is Monte Carlo. And that's what is done in TRPO. Whereas in those techniques, where generally you use temporal difference methods that I have explained to you using this reward prediction error that I have told you about. Okay. Yeah, one point is that in evolutionary methods, you have episodes that gives you a return, and that this tells you how to adapt your policy given on whether the return were good or not. Okay. In those iterative techniques, you also use Monte Carlo techniques, so you run episodes, but from these episodes, you generate a critique. So you have something that tells you the value of being in a particular state with a given action, which you don't have in evolutionary method. That's the main difference. But those techniques using Monte Carlo are much closer to evolutionary methods than the temporal difference methods. Okay. And it's so in the incremental case, your critique is updated with new data each time. And that's the case of DDPG, and that's also the case of some other algorithm that I will tell you about. This is also the case when you are using n-step temporal differences, which is something that I will explain immediately. Okay? And being incremental is better in terms of sample efficiency, because you don't throw away your critique and need many data again to compute a new critique. You just update a critique, so you need less samples, and you can reuse samples that you have in your replay buffer with this and less with that. So now the difference between Monte Carlo method, one-step temporal difference, and n-step temporal difference methods. So in Monte Carlo, I have assumed that you all know what it is so far, but in fact, I should have explained. So you start from a state, and you draw some actions according to some probabilities until the end of some episode. For instance, where you are playing Go, you just start from one position, and you start making moves at Go until the end of the game. And if the game is, if you win, you get something positive. If you lost, you get something negative. And this gives you the return of playing that particular action in that particular state. Okay? That's Monte Carlo. And in the case where you have a discounted reward, which is represented here, you start from state A0, you play the whole episode, and you backpropagate the reward up to the value of state A0. In the one-step temporal difference technique, which is what I have shown you so far with DQN and DDPG, you just perform one action, And you say that the value of the next state is updated given your current reward and the value of the previous state. You don't need to go further because what you get further is summarized by the value of the current state. Okay? And in end step return, you get something which is intermediate, which is that you do this, but over n steps, instead of doing over an infinite horizon or up to the end of your episode. Okay? So now what is quite important is that Monte Carlo methods, they suffer from variance because from the state, same state, you will perform many different trajectories, so you will get many different returns, and the longer the return, the longer your trajectories, the larger the variance of your return. Okay. Okay. And in fact, this variance comes if everything is deterministic just from exploration because you are trying different actions. And that's something that took me time to understand that in fact this was not an issue about stochastic trajectories, this was just due to exploration. If your system is stochastic, you get even more variance due to this stochasticity. But that's not the key phenomenon. The key phenomenon here is exploration. Okay? The point is that Monte Carlo is on policy. You need one policy and you play with this policy from different states and you get the return that you obtain with that particular policy. Okay. By contrast, temporal difference methods, they suffer from bias. This is this famous or infamous over estimation bias that I've told you about. That in fact, if this value V of S1 is wrong, this error will propagate there. And so the estimate that you will get here will be biased due to this previous errors. Okay. And if you use n-step temporal difference techniques, you have a way. If n goes towards the length of your episode, you go towards Monte Carlo. And if n goes towards 1, you go towards TD. So you can control whether you want more bias if you get more TD, or more bias, more variance if you get more Monte Carlo. Okay. And in fact, I will tell you when I will present to you the most recent algorithms that a lot of them are using this n-step trick. Because controlling the bias-variance trade-off is one of the central issues in the current deep reinforcement learning literature. About the papers here. Okay, yes, something that was about to forget. Thank you, in fact, Mathieu, for that. Is that in this paper, they show that instead of using n-step returns, you can also use lambda returns, where lambda is about using what is called eligibility traces. I won't go into that, but in fact, you have different ways to propagate the values with what is called eligibility traces. And in fact, in this paper, they study the relationship between the two and show that this is not the same, and that using lambda return is often better than using n-step return. But I don't master this well enough to tell you more. Okay, so it seems that using n-step return is a good idea. But when first thinking about it, I had a problem on how to integrate n-step return in DDPG. Because in DDPG, as I told you, one key trick for stabilizing the algorithm is to shuffling, you shuffle the samples, so they are in a random order, so you don't know what are the successive steps again. Okay. So if you want to use this step return, you cannot shuffle the samples anymore. So I had a hard time to understand how they do this. This is not very well described into the papers. Actually, in one algorithm that I will tell you later about, which is called A3C, they use n-step return, but they don't use a replay buffer just because of that. But in fact, in a recent paper, this was described more accurately. And what you will do is that each sample will contain the information about n successive steps. And this one will be from S0 to S3, and this one will be from S1 to S4, and S1, okay, so the states and actions, etc., are repeated over the different samples so that you can shuffle them. You keep the information locally in all samples, okay? Okay, and one question that we started to wonder about with Emmanuel Rachelson is that if you do so, in fact, inside your samples, you are more or less on policy because that depends on the policy you are playing. So you are somewhere between on-policy and off-policy when you are mixing those things. That's a little weird. And okay, something very important is that in D4PG, which is one of the top state-of-the-art paper, NSAC and PPO, they are all using N-step returns. And in D4PG, they show convincingly that in fact this is the main factor of success of D4PG. So I believe that's important to go towards this, if you want to have something efficient. Now, from the current background, I can start presenting you the second family of deep reinforcement learning algorithm. And again, here, I don't understand these algorithms in detail. So I will just try to explain the main ideas, but I am not able to provide an in-depth presentation as I tried to do with DDPG. So trust regime policy optimization is a paper from John Shulman, who is having many theoretical and interesting papers. And so he starts with some theory. He wants to build a continuous state and action reinforcement learning algorithm where you get some monotonous improvements, which means that your policy at the next state will be better than the policy at the previous one. Okay. And he designed some theory about this. In fact, the theory is built on some assumptions that cannot be applied in practice. And then he derives the practical algorithms. And in fact, the first algorithm is the TRPO, and it seems to work well. Okay. So basically what he does is that he casts the policy improvement problem as an optimization problem, where in fact you want to minimize an expectation. There are different elements, so that's not so easy. Here you have a term that is related to important sampling that I will explain later on. And here you have a critique. And this should tell you that from a step to the next, your critique should improve. I'm not sure that Nicolas, if you want to explain this quickly, it will be better. And then what is important, what matters to me is that he adds a constraint, which is that the Kullback-Leibler divergence between the current policy and the previous one should not be too large. I already told you that in DDPG, there was a mechanism, this target actor mechanism, which the idea is that your actor should not change too quickly for various reasons, and we will try to investigate those reasons later in this talk. This importance sampling term is used, okay, how to explain this? In fact, if you want to evaluate a policy, you will have samples, you will generate samples from this policy, and then given the return in these samples, you can tell whether this policy is right or wrong. Okay. Now, if you take a different policy, you can still be able, you still want to evaluate a target policy from a different policy. What you can say is, okay, if the samples are the same as in the policy that I am evaluating, I take these samples seriously. And if they are very different, I should not take them very seriously, so I will decrease their importance so that my evaluation keeps correct. And if the two samples are very different, I should completely ignore them. And in fact, this importance sampling term tells you something about, okay, I forgot to mention that in this world, we are now playing with completely stochastic policies, okay? And this term tells you that if the two policies are very close to each other, this term will be very close to one, okay? Because the probability of performing this action is more or less the same for the two policies. Whereas if they are very different, maybe this will be close to zero or this will be close to infinity, okay? Later on I will show you that when it's close to infinity, in fact, you should cut them, ignore them. And then, the Kullback-Leibler divergence term between both policies makes sure that the current policy is not so different from the previous policies. More technically, the Kullback-Leibler divergence compares two distributions, and say whether they are close or not. And the distribution that you take is the distribution of actions generated by the policy given a large number of states. And so that's an expectation. I will try to explain this better in the next slide. So to perform this optimization, in fact, TRPO is using a second order conjugate gradient method, which is quite exotic with respect to the, all the gradient descent techniques that were used before. And you will see that with PPO, it has changed this. Okay. Let's say that in practice, TRPO is much more stable than DDPG. It performs well, but it's less sample efficient, so it's performing well, but slower. And in practice, one important aspect is that you don't have to tune a step size because you are using this Kullback-Leibler divergence trick. And one open question is that it is supposed that using the, but again, Nicolas will be able to explain this at least to me and Thomas in the next days, using this constraint on the Kullback-Leibler divergence should constrain the gradient to follow what is called the natural gradient. I've told you that this is related to using the advantage function, okay? But actually, this constraint is theoretical, and what you do in practice is something approximate, so it's not so sure that in practice you really follow the natural gradient. What I should say immediately is that we believe with Nicolas that, in fact, using this Kullback-Leibler divergence constraints makes sure that the stochastic policy that in the beginning has a lot of variants will not be too different from policy to policy, so the variants won't decrease very fast. Okay? If your optimal policy is a deterministic policy, it may happen if you don't use this constraint that in fact it will stop explore very fast. Okay, and by adding this constraint, in fact, you make sure that exploration is still there. And this is what matters, in fact, in the story. That's what we are now convinced about. So in fact, yeah, and if you follow, there is a blog, I don't have the reference here, from Ben Recht, that explains to you that using a deterministic policy is a much better idea than using a stochastic policy. And here they are combining two tricks. They force having the stochastic policies and having variants on that stochastic policy so as to make sure that you will explore enough. But this might be a very bad idea if your problem needs a deterministic policy to be accurate. In the case where you have a system that you want to be very stable, you don't want it to try many different things. You want it to just be deterministic. So how do you estimate the Kullback-Leibler divergence? Okay, this is an expectation, Kullback-Leibler divergence that you need is in fact an expectation over the states as generated by your current trajectory, by your current policy, okay? So you cannot get this integral over an infinite number of episodes. So what you do is that you need to generate many trajectories from the current policy. For each state, you sample the actions from the current policy and from the previous policies. This is quite expensive to do this, okay? And then you can compute the divergence between the distribution of actions here and actions there, okay? So you can see that you need a lot of data to do this. This is why it is slow and expensive. And those two policies should be close to each other. This is why you need to be on policy, okay? So the question is that, in fact, you cannot perform this very accurately, so you need some approximations. And the question is whether the natural gradient relationship is still verified given those approximations. You could perform this Kyle divergence computation between your current policy and any different policy. But then you would need to keep those policies to be able to generate new samples, so you would need a huge replay buffer with the different policies if you want this to be off policy. Anyways, given the important sampling term, if the different policies you are evaluating with the Kyle divergence are too different, your update of the critique will be cut because the difference between the terms is too large, okay, and this won't work. So you can only apply this in an on-policy context, and you can only apply this when your policy is changing slowly from step to step. So there is no way to have an off-policy TRPO that would be much more sample efficient. Okay. So PPO is the next paper, one of the next papers from Shulman again. So that's exactly the same idea as TRPO, but as I told you, this fraction could go towards infinity if this term goes to zero and this one is large. Okay. So you clip this value if it's behind a particularly high value. I don't know, that's a parameter in fact. Okay. And then it uses standard stochastic gradient descent, so the kind of stuff that you get with TensorFlow, instead of using the conjugate gradient. It also uses an n-step return instead of using Monte Carlo. So it goes closer to something that is off policy, but not completely. And then the implementation is much simpler. The performance is a little better. So PPO started to get used much more than TRPO, which was difficult to code because you had to code a conjugate gradient method and not so many people can know to do this. Okay. But this is still on policy because those two policies, again, due to the important sampling term, cannot be different from each other that much. Okay. Okay. And this PPO algorithm has been used in many impressive results. For instance, this one, emergence of locomotion behaviors in rich environments, where they show a humanoid starting to jump in many different environments very efficiently. But that's slow. Okay, a completely different algorithm. At the moment, I am more presenting a zoo of algorithms and not so many principles. The principles have been presented before or will be presented in the end. So NAF is more related to DDPG or to DQN, in fact. But that's a kind of DQN with using the advantage function instead of using the vanilla gradient and the standard critique network. So I told you that the advantage function can be defined this way. Okay. So that's, or you can express the Q function as the advantage plus the value. That's the trick of the value the dueling networks. Okay. And what they do in addition is that the complicated part in an actor or in a deep reinforcement learning problem where the action is continuous is to perform a max over the actions. But if your policy has a particular shape, for instance, if it's quadratic in terms of the action, finding the max is can be done very easily because it's easy to find a max in a quadratic problem. Okay? So they constrain the policy to have this particular quadratic shape. Okay? And by doing so, they are able to recover the action very efficiently. So after a set of little equations, they end up with some architecture where you have the states, the actions, you have your global advantage function that is here, you have the value plus the advantage function, okay? And here, in fact, mu is the policy that you are learning. You learn a Q network exactly as in DQN, but the fact that the network is very structured instead of being just a set of neurons, it's structured mathematically, and you are able to compute the derivative of all these boxes. Okay, and if you train this Q network with data as you do with DQN, little by little, those matrices here will get structured so as to solve the problem, and among other things, this one will be structured as the policy that maximizes that particular advantage value function. Okay. This tells you how the L matrix is organized, but forget about it. In the NAF paper, they also use model-based reinforcement learning using an ALQG algorithm for model-based acceleration. Okay, I won't go into the details. They are able to apply this to real robotic manipulation problems. But again, I asked students to try NAF in competition with DDPG, and they found that they didn't succeed in finding a stable parameterization. So they did not find hyperparameters that were working well. So it's hard to conclude. And actually, this paper is not much cited anymore. So I've told you a word about A2C and A3C. So A2C, A3C, 3C is the asynchronous parallel version of A2C. Okay. So in this case, you have several actors that are interacting with the environment. You are collecting the data from these parallel actors, and the fact that they are running parallel makes it that the samples, that you get the samples in a random order. So you get the samples more or less IID, and you don't need a replay buffer shuffling the step for that. So they don't have a replay buffer. And since they don't have this replay buffer and they didn't have to think about it, they can use this end step return ID with the samples they get from the different agents. A point also is that they are using a specific form for the gradient that in fact uses the advantage function. I told you that using the advantage function was a good idea. So this is the complete return over a Monte Carlo episode. And if you subtract the value function, as you do for the advantage function, you get something that is related to the advantage. Another point is that this is a very, very early algorithm where they add a regularization term which tries to maximize the entropy. Okay, and in fact, maximizing the entropy is making sure that your algorithm will keep high variance. And again, this is related to exploration. This is related to a TRPO which does not want the variance to go too small. And I will tell you about different algorithms which also use this entropy regularization term so as to improve the exploration term. So again, the exploration is something central in these ideas. One point is that for doing this, you need to learn a model of the value function. And I have read in a few papers, and I can't find the reference anymore, that this is not a good idea because V is the max over the Q function. So it might be more difficult to estimate than the Q function itself. OK, one very recent algorithm from the same group as TRPO, PPO, etc., so from OpenAI, is soft actor critic. So the idea is to have more or less DDPG, but soft means that you have something that is entropy regularized. So they more or less do DDPG. Now, a big difference is that the actor is stochastic and not deterministic. So they are not using the deterministic polylinear gradient. They are using something that is stochastic. Okay, but they have some entropy regularization, and they show on a set of standard Mujoko and OpenAI experiments that SAC performs faster, much faster than TRPO, and is more stable than DDPG, so is defeating both DDPG and TRPO in all instances of problems that they have tried. Okay. One important aspect is that, okay, so they had this entropy regularization. As a follow-up, of there are several papers about using entropy regularization in more theoretical papers, let's say. What's interesting is that they don't study the effect of this entropy term. I would be glad to see if the entropy tends to converge to zero in the end, if you get to something that is more or less deterministic. But they did not study this. And also, they don't anneal down the weight of the regularization term. It would be a good idea to remove regularization in the end so as to get something that is more deterministic, and it did not try this. You are lucky, there are three algorithms that are called ACER, Qprop. No, in fact, there are two, and IPG is more a common framework for those two algorithms, who tried to combine the good ideas of DDPG and the good ideas of TRPO by having something that is off policy, stable, with less various, less bias, etc. Those papers are quite mathematical, and in fact, you get the hyperparameters of TRPO, the hyperparameters of DDPG, so this is just not the way to go. And okay, there has been three or four papers about this more or less simultaneously, and they completely disappeared. And in fact, to me, the point is that those algorithms were proposed by, in particular, DeepMind, where only those guys are able to put into the same code something this complicated and to try to tune it with those many students. That's a dead end. But there are some interesting maths into that, anyways. And the fundamental instability issue is still there. A word about actor, which should be of interest to Thomas here in the room. So I told you that computing the natural gradient and using the advantage function might be good ideas, and this is something that we have to dig into. And in fact, there is a different way to estimate the natural gradient, which is based on something mathematical, which is called Kronecker factored approximated curvature. Okay, using the natural gradient is a way to estimate the curvature of the space in which you are computing your gradient. Okay. And this makes the estimation of the natural gradient faster. Okay. And in fact, ACKTR can be seen as a TRPO with a natural gradient calculation, but it's also actor critic, so this is also somewhere between DDPG and TRPO. And what they put forward in the paper is that ACKTR, in fact you should call it ACKTR, is not much more efficient than using standard gradient descent, so vanilla gradient. And it improves the sample efficiency, so it's better. Actually, people from the Deep Reinforcement Learning That Matters paper have tried to reproduce that their result and were showing that ACKTR was not performing that better than the rest. So it more or less disappeared at the moment. But okay. In fact, when I say disappeared, I have to say that all the papers that I am started, I am less than 1 year old. So. Okay, we don't have much distance in terms of what will continue to be cited and what won't. A word about D4PG, so that's distributed, distributional, deterministic, deep deterministic policy gradient, okay? So that's from a nice idea from Marc Bellemare and Rémi Munoz, among others, okay? The idea is that since you get very different returns from the same Monte Carlo process, instead of just getting some average about this, you might keep the distribution and try to perform Bayesian-like computation with this distribution. And by doing so, they get something that is much more stable. They try different forms of distributions, categorical, which is more or less a histogram or mixture of Gaussian, and this is the standard DDPG. And they show that combined with, in the D4PG paper, which is an ICLR paper this year, they show that combined with prioritized experience replay and step return, they get something that is very good. And let me say that those distributional policy gradient techniques are a very hot topic at the moment. There are many papers from strong groups that are pushed in that direction. So I would be interested in going into the details of that, but that's unfortunately quite mathematical. So I have tried to explain to you in the case of SARSA and Q-learning the on policies versus off policies distinction. In fact, there is much more to say in the case of continuous action domain. One of the papers that you should read if you want to know more about this is the paper about retrace, or you should read Matthew Zimmer's PhD, which has a chapter about this, which is quite interesting. Okay, the idea is that they investigate under which condition off policy techniques can be stable in the continuous action domain. And from this retrace algorithm, they propose a ReACKTR algorithm, which is in fact presented in the discrete action case. But they say a word about the fact that this could be applied to the continuous action domain, but so far I have not seen used, and they propose a different way to perform a gradient computation that looks interesting. Okay, I won't go into the details again. This was just to give a more complete picture. So I have finished my zoo, and now I am ready to go to the big picture again. Have you any questions at the moment? No? The answer is, let's say, 10 minutes. Okay, so that's the big picture. So I have told you that in fact, this one, the very first, and okay, in fact, the field can be organized this way. You have DDPG as a starting point or TRPO as a starting point, okay? In the case of TRPO, you are on policy, you are stable, but you are sample inefficient. Whereas in the case of DDPG, you are off policy, you are sample efficient, but you are unstable, okay? And a lot of the domain can be seen as an attempt to get something that is off policy, stable, and sample efficient, so as to combine the properties of both families. Okay, so to me, the worst attempts are those ones. Okay, they try to combine everything and put an algorithm that does all this stuff, and this is too complex. And you can see that just by adding an actor critique and entropy regularized stuff, you can switch from PPO from to SAC, which is much more sample efficient, for instance. You can see that using the advantage function gave rise to the algorithms that were supposed to be better than DDPG. H3C both uses the advantage function and n-step returns. And D4PG uses n-step return, it's most type and it's of policy. And in their paper, they show that D4PG in the benchmark that they have used is better than PPO. But the comparison which is missing definitely at the moment is between SAC and D4PG. I have told you that the TD3, which uses several critics, is very interesting because it addresses one of the fundamental problems, which is this bias propagation problem, which is at the heart of the bias variance problem. Okay. And also, I should also show that there are different companies behind those people. So you have influence from DeepMind, which is rather there, and influence from OpenAI, which is rather there. But there are people who collaborate into some of these papers, so the picture is a little more complex than that. And I would say that to me, the state of the art of the moment is SAC versus D4PG, and TD3 is making a very important point at the moment. Okay?
One question on this picture. So here you discussed it from the point of view of around policy stability and sample efficiency. But what about continuous actions versus discrete actions?
In fact, this picture is intended to be about continuous action. DQN is there because this is the ancestor. And reactor is there because it could be applied to continuous action. But I have been completely focused on continuous action. And in fact, about discrete action, I have not read much. This is a bias in my own research. So I just know about DQN, and I am not following much about what else matters in the story. So I've told you that a lot of these tricks seem to be involved in keeping the variants large so that you explore. Okay. So there are arguments for using stochastic policies. Yeah, because policy parameter perturbation will provide some exploration. The KL divergence constraints mostly prevents premature convergence to policy determinism. Okay. But I've read this in a few papers where they are aware that if the exploration is decreasing too quickly, then you will end up into a poor local minimum. Okay. But the point is that in some problems, policy determinism is desirable, so you would not like your variance to stay large at the moment. So you should read this blog post about that. Yeah, and then I wanted to make a point that in fact, again, Nicolas made, which is that for all these algorithms, you need to estimate a gradient that tells you that changing this action a little will drive you towards higher performance or lower performance. Okay. And if you have trajectories that are close enough to each other, then you have this local gradient information because you have samples that are close to each other and you can perform accurate gradient computation. But if you have trajectories that are far away from each other, through your critique, you can use them to improve your critique. But in fact, you are computing a gradient from values that are very far away from each other, and you are using some interpolation, which might be very poor for exploring. So there might be some issues here to be investigated more than that. This was my first take-home messages, and I hope I don't need to repeat them that much. So again, temporal difference methods reuse more samples but suffer from bias and may run stable. Monte Carlo methods suffer from variance, reuse less samples but are more stable. N-step returns offer a compromise between the two. And stochastic policies are used for exploration, but combining deterministic policies with dedicated exploration mechanism may be preferred. Among the topics that I have not covered at all, In particular, DeepMind, but also Google, Google Brain, etc., are also playing a lot with using these algorithms with very heavy architectures where you can use hundreds or even thousands of computers in parallel to make computation faster. Okay. This one, for instance, is funny. Distributed deep reinforcement learning, learning how to play Atari game in 21 minutes, because it took something like 3 months to train the initial DQN. Okay. And what they do is just they parallelize everything as much as they do with a hardcore parallelization, let's say. Okay. And I don't believe that for public labs like us, this is the way to go, because we don't have the many engineers that you need to do this efficiently. So word about the current status of the field. So it's clear that big companies like DeepMind, Google Brain, OpenAI is not clearly a big company, but anyway, are ruling the game. And they are imposing onto the community a focus on performance. Okay, I have told you mostly about performance, much less about analysis of the algorithms, sample efficiency, etc. Okay. But hopefully, people like the McGill people with their DeepRL That Matters paper have shown that those algorithms are often stable, they are hard to compare, they are sensitive to hyperparameters. So this is putting high stress on public labs like us to ask us to reproduce this result to perform these comparisons. Okay, so this is not so fair. Okay. Yeah, another point that I want to stress is that the basic performance comparisons is done with these OpenAI, Mujoco, DeepMind Control Suite benchmarks. When in fact you have a humanoid, you put your algorithm, this is black box, and you end up with a performance and you are very happy. But often in empirical sciences, and particularly in life sciences, what you do is that you design your experiment so as to put forward a particular feature. And here it's very difficult to analyze why this algorithm is performing better than this one, just because the benchmarks are not meant for that. You cannot analyze in details. So there are a few papers where they design their own setup so that changing that particular aspect of the environment will result in better performance for that algorithm, but not for that one, so you can better understand what's happening. And I believe that's the way to go towards simpler benchmarks where you can analyze what's happening. Okay. There is still fast performance progress despite those instabilities, etc. And okay, I've told you that to me exploration is one of the hot topics in the domain, and also one of the hot topics now is applying those techniques in the multitask learning context, curriculum learning, etc. And that's more or less the topic of tomorrow, so I won't go into that. And that's not for you. And that's it. You survived. Me too. You had many opportunities to ask questions before, so that's all.
I had a question on the replay buffer. So it seems that it's very important to shuffle experience. It's the basis of the first DeepMind paper. But at the same time, there seems to be a lot of ideas that consist in prioritizing experience. So removing some shuffling. And for example, in the paper mentioned by Jean, it seems that even having very small buffers and thus having very recent experience is better. So is there any theoretical analysis of why shuffling is necessary exactly, other than the proof that it is necessary for the algorithm to converge? Or what is necessary for the replay buffer to contain which kind of experience is it necessary to be in the buffer for it to work properly? Or
to me, the theoretical argument in favor of replay buffer shuffling is this idea that your samples should be IID, and if you don't shuffle them, they are very correlated to each other.
Yeah, but it seems that it's not that bad to have correlated in some cases. You said, for example, that with prioritized experience replay, a new experience is systematically considered very interesting. and new experiences are correlated.
Sure.
So what is the link, where is the threshold between correlated is good and correlated is bad, actually?
I believe, okay, I can't answer myself, but I believe that Richard Sutton is a lot on that question, so he has this paper called A Deeper Look at Experience Replay, etc. So there are attempts to try to investigate those questions, more theoretical than practical, or both. Yeah, but I'm not able to give you more about this at the moment. But you should read definitely Zhang Zhen Sutton papers. That this is not done yet. Yes.
Yeah, I would like to know why do you think deterministic policies are preferable, and why are the
the reason why you think that? Because, for example, I think of work hypotheses where.
Sure. To me, this completely depends on the experiments. Yeah, if, for instance, you take the Hopper experiment or any humanoid, if you are pushing, if you are going to the front too much, you will fall. If you go do the same from backward too much, you will fall. So the amount of exploration you can allow around the optimal actions is very small. Okay, there is a very nice analysis in the context of evolutionary strategies from the group of Uber Labs showing that in case where in fact you have a very narrow domain around the optimal policy, and in that case methods that explore very few will be able to find the optimum, whereas those which explore a lot will get stuck because a lot, very often, they will get samples that are very bad and they won't make progress at all. So that completely depends on the problem. But for many robotics problems, you want to be very accurate because otherwise you fall, you damage your system, etc., etc. Yes? Alain.
If I can add some insight, so I would say, regarding to your question about deterministic versus stochastic policies, one of the theoretical results is that if your problem can be seen as a Markov decision process, real Markov decision process, then you know that the best policy is deterministic.
Yeah.
And that in most cases, you are not solving your Markov decision process. Mm-hmm. And in that case, it can be that a stochastic policy can have better results than any deterministic policy. So, to add to what Olivier said, it's very dependent on the problem you are solving. And also, when you add neural networks, you're making estimations of things. So, maybe something which is at the core of a Markov decision problem can be non-Markovian because of these estimators you have everywhere. And maybe I have also something on the question about. The replay buffer. I think that one of the basic idea of using IID samples is that when you have a neural network and estimator, if you have all the data, you could compute the real gradient of this thing. But you don't have that. And mathematically speaking, if you want to estimate a good estimate of this gradient can only be done if you have IID samples. So that's the idea of IID samples. But now we are working on reinforcement learning problems where we have a sequence of things. And I'm not sure that also in all these estimators, we have Adam Knight, the core algorithm at the base of neural networks. They also have, when you have a gradient, you have also some kind of inertia or things like that. So maybe in a reinforcement learning problem where we are not learning a static function, but you are learning something which has sequential that can move, the fact that you can keep a certain sequence of input samples is maybe also used or taken advantage of these things in the core algorithms to have some kind of inertia.
Yes, a momentum.
The sequence somewhere. So I think that finding a compromise between IID and keeping a sequence of samples is very hard to determine. So this is the whole extent.
Maybe a word to say that my slides will be available on demand, but maybe having 30 emails asking for my slides is not the better policy, so we should put this slide somewhere and distribute an email to everybody who was there so that you can get them. Okay, we will figure out a way to do so.
I'd like to ask a general question. So actually in your talk you focused on model 3 deep reinforcement learning approaches.
Yes.
Could you say a few words on beyond the fact that that's one of the specialties on which you are working, the model 3?
No, that's not the case.
Could you give some insight about why you chose to focus on those ones? Why it seems that this is the center of focus of current deep reinforcement learning research, and what you think are the potential interesting things to discuss or to be worked on model-based deep RL?
First of all, I make profit of the question to show you my model-based video. So you are the agent performing Q-learning as before, but it's doing model-based learning, and you will see that at the moment it is learning in fact the structure of the problem, but when it will have found the reward, this will happen after, but it needs to explore for a long time, otherwise this model will be very wrong. But the value propagates in the network and that's it. So this is much faster than learning. Okay. The students like this video a lot. Okay, so more seriously, there are several aspects. One aspect is that using a model. Okay, there are many aspects. One aspect is that a lot of these works are done in simulation, and in simulation, you don't care much about sample efficiency, which means that in fact, you have the simulation as a model, which is available. You can use the simulation to get some additional information about your system just by asking the simulation itself rather than asking your model, which is might be wrong. Okay? So it's not so clear that in the case where you are using a simulation, where sample efficiency is not an issue, using a model that you are learning is better than using the simulation itself as model. And in fact, your replay buffer is a kind of model that tells you that if you try this action in that state, if your replay buffer has the correct sample, it will tell you what is the next state. Okay. So it is not so easy to see why it would be better to use model-based reinforcement learning when you are using simulation. When you are using a robot, this is completely different, because if you have your own model, your own internal simulation, you can perform some TD backups in your mind without having to sample with the robot itself. So this is much less expensive. So to me, model-based reinforcement learning is much more interesting in the case where you are using robots rather than in the case where you are using simulation. And actually, this is completely the line of research of Jean-Baptiste Moret at the moment, who is trying to show that in robotics, that's not as in the deep reinforcement learning domain where you use a lot of big data. He says you use as small data as you can, because getting data is very expensive with a robot. Okay, so that's an important point. Another point is that using a model can be a way to fight against the overestimation bias. If your model is accurate, in fact, you can perform your backpropagation much more accurately than if you are just guessing from a guess of a... Okay, let's say that... I forgot to say this. The bias propagation problem in reinforcement learning is often coined with the term that's guessing from another guess. Okay, you have a guess of V of ST plus 1 and you guess V of ST from this other guess. Okay, if you are using model-based updates, in fact, this can be mitigated. That's hard to explain why, but I had this idea clear at the moment. Okay, but the point is that if your model is wrong, then you get a bias that is much worse than the bias you get just from temporal difference updates. So in many papers, for instance, in the Dizendrotz and all paper where they provide a survey of policy search techniques, they show that you can improve things with model-based methods, but that depends on the quality of your model, and the quality of your model depends on the quality of your samples, and finally, it's not so clear that you will get something that is better in the end. So the success stories of model-based reinforcement learning at the moment are not so numerous, and there are many works these last year or 2 years, even at DeepMind, Google Brain, etc., who try to use model-based reinforcement learning in deep reinforcement learning with not so much success. So it's not so clear at the moment. Let me say that in sharp contrast with what we said, my 15 first years about reinforcement learning was about model-based reinforcement learning, and I was convinced that this was the way to go. But at the moment, it seems that model-free works better. And but it's not so easy to figure out.
Because I think in addition, there is another dimension, which is, I think, is an advantage of model-based methods, which is the multi-goal or the multitask framework and generalization to novel tasks in the same environment. Because I guess that if you do model-free reinforcement learning in the same environment, you learn the first task, it takes a long time. Now someone gives you another task, it will take a lot of time. But if you have a model,
yeah, sure,
then you could potentially generalize directly. And I think that maybe one of the reasons why model-free RL is right now very hot is that people have not actually considered so much the multitask or multi-goal. They have not considered real robots first, I would agree with that, and they have not considered multitask, multi-goal.
Actually, one of the guys who is the most active about model-based reinforcement learning is Sergey Levin, who is trying to use robots, so there is a strong correlation there. Another point that I wanted to mention, we discussed that already, is that in the life sciences, you have this distinction between model-based and model-free reinforcement learning and methods that try to combine the two. And they explain to you that model-based reinforcement learning corresponds to goal-oriented behavior and model-free reinforcement learning to habit learning. And in fact, what's funny is that the model-based reinforcement learning view about goal-oriented behavior, in this view, there is no goal. You just have a reward function. And having something which is an explicit goal is very different from having just a reward function. And probably if you had an explicit goal in the model-based part, you could perform this generalization much better than just from this scarce signal that is just a scala and that tells you very few about what you should do. So probably the way to go, and that we saw a paper from Levin who goes in that direction, the way to go is to have the model-based part with explicit goals and the model-free part just with scalar rewards that might be intrinsic motivations related to your goals. Okay. That's for the next PhD. Who wants to do this PhD?
Yeah, maybe another point is that if you want to use a model, you probably need a good model over the whole state space. So explore much more than if you just want to use some kind of policy optimization, which would probably find a local optima without trying part of a state space. Probably it's much more difficult to learn a model than a good policy. After that, you gain the possibility to generalize much easily to new tasks.
Yeah, that's one point of Dizendrot, who was designing this PILCO algorithm, that in fact learning a model is more difficult than learning a policy. So in the case where both are complicated, it's model-free methods will offer an optimum faster than model-based techniques. But of course you are right, when you are trying to address several tasks, then the advantage might be short-sighted.
But there are also some robots for which you know actually very well the model without learning. And even if you know the model, you still cannot solve tasks. So there is still a lot to learn, even if you have the model. For example, if you have a humanoid robot that you know perfectly, still, if the reward is to go forward, you need to find things to make it work, and that's not just the model that will give you this.
Yeah, but what's funny is that if you use, for instance, a humanoid, and you are using a humanoid in simulation, having a model of your simulation inside your agent and having your simulation itself is not so different, so it's not clear why having this model inside your agent would be better.
Because you can differentiate, maybe. So compute gradients and things like this, if you have an analytical model, for example.
Okay, your simulation would not be differentiable.
Maybe not. Okay. I mean, you can just...
Yeah, that's the point.
Maybe one use of a model would be to give some approximate solution that would be then tuned by the model-free methods, or model-free methods like, because they are computing gradients. And if you start from the solution which is not very bad, you have better chances to find a good solution than if you start with nothing.
Okay, there are, apart from just using a model for that, there are many papers about using exploration first and then doing this. This is what Cedric will tell you about tomorrow, but a lot are also doing imitation learning first and then model-free. And okay, what you mentioned is also true. So okay, the point is to get something good very quickly and then to improve with model-free techniques.
And also have things the other way. I mean, you should check your model from time to time. I mean, this is the idea behind Jean-Baptiste's work. I mean, if you have a model but it's not a good model, then you will find very bad solutions. So yeah, from time to time, you should check that your solutions that you have computed using the model or whatever works in reality, if you have a robot or whatever. So, I mean, the tool is nice, but it's very difficult to have, at the same time, model-based and model-free methods that enrich each other.